Yes, ma'am.
Very good morning to one and all present here. Here now I am going to take share something about the machine learning algorithms and its application in power systems. And in this session, what are the key things I am going to address is some of the basic concepts of machine learning and the mathematical background of very important machine algorithm, that's linear regression, and the different other ML algorithms used for classification problems. And after designing a machine learning algorithm or design, what are the performance metrics we are using to evaluate whether our model is correct or not? That is the performance metrics. So I'm going to touch all these things. And starting with the basic question, what is machine learning? So there are so many definitions given by great scientist. So the basic definition is, it's a field of study. It gives a computer the ability to learn without being programmed. So normally we program machines, but if they have ability to learn by themselves, then it is called machine learning. And from the modern definition, explains with three parameters: the experience and the measure and the task. So the Tom Mitchell provides the definition like this. To understand this definition, we can take an example of playing chess or a Chinese checker. So the task of a computer is to win the game. So the task. So for what the machine is going to learn, that's the task. And P is a probability of winning. So how the machine has learned, whether it learns, it will win. So the probability of winning. And how this probability of winning can be improved by the experience of the machine. So these three are the key items: experience, what's the task, and what's the probability of being win. So in general, if you see, any machine learning algorithms can have two broad classifications: supervised and unsupervised learning. So as a human, we learn from experience. So we learn from experience. How a machine works is, we will program a machine and the machine will follow instructions. But in machine learning, what we expect is, besides following instructions, the machine should also learn like us from experience. So this is what we from any machine learning. So how a machine can have experience? As a human, we are undergoing so many circumstances and situations, and we are gaining our experience and learning day by day. How a machine can do it? So the learn from experience is equivalent to learning from data in point of machine. So it is a machine learning. Machine is going to learn like us, but we are having our own experiences in our own words. Machine can learn using data. So the very basic thing is supervised learning. So in supervised learning, what is the thing is, we are having a data set. So for our learning, if we want to learn alphabet, we have to provide a book or something which will give a statement A, B, C, D. A should be written like this, B should be written like this. So we should have some data set for learning. That's the book for learning. So if in supervised learning, if we have the relationship between the input and output clearly, then it is a supervised learning. So what is the relationship between input and output? Suppose I'm considering a very simple example. I want to analyze or get the cost of a house in a particular area. So if I want to purchase a house in Chennai, so I am having some data set. So we are having so many features that fixes the data. Output cost of the house. So the data may be having some of the characteristics like size of a house, area of a house, and the basic amenities, and the what is the style of the house. And we are having so many parameters like this. So the features are different. Suppose I am considering for simplicity only one feature, that is the size of a house. So I am going to have a relationship. If the size of a house is this much square feet, then the cost will be like this. So based on this particular relationship, if I collect so many relationships like this, based on, so I am just having a data set. the X is the size of the house, and Y is the cost of the house. So I'm having so many known inputs, and based on the input, I am making my machine to learn. So the machine is continuously reading this data and learning. And for a different square feet land, if I give as an input, then the machine should be able to provide the cost of that particular house, which is not, it is already trained. So some data set, I am giving some data set of 100 or 200 different houses to the machine and ask machine to learn. So the machine will use some algorithms to learn. After learning, I will ask a machine for new question, for new data set. So it will give me an answer. So this is the base of machine learning. So for a machine to learn, we are providing some data set. Based on the data set, it is learning. And after learning, for any new information, it is able to provide the solution for us. So for the learning, if you provide both the input and output details, it is called as supervised learning. If you are not at all confident about the output, and if you are having only a group of input, then the machine itself starts clustering the inputs, and it is actually unsupervised learning, where the real outputs, what we expect, is not available. Here, in the supervised learning, the supervised learning is categorized into two problems, regression problem and classification problem. So what is a regression problem is? For our simplicity, we can easily understand the regression problem will be having a continuous output. The classification problem will be having a discrete output. So for example, the same example I'm repeating, if I give a size of a house and I want a cost as an output, then it is a continuous output variable. The cost may be from some X amount of rupees to some Y amount of rupees, and it is continuous in values. So this problem is actually a regression problem. So what is a classification problem? So for example, if we are treating some medical records, and if you are determining a COVID patients, for example, so if based on the report of the patient or some features of the patient, we are classifying whether the patient is COVID positive or negative, then such a problem is treated as a classification problem. Here the output may be positive or negative, zero or one, true or false, only discrete categories. So such a problems are called classification problems. And when the output is continuous, such as forecasting something, then the problem will be treated as a regression problem. So these are the two types of supervised learning. So for easy understanding, this is a hint. For supervised learning, right answers are already given for learning. In two types, regression, the output is continuous. So we need to predict that continuous value. In classification value, we need to predict a discrete output, zero or one. So to make it clear, just I have shown here two problems. Problem number one is, you have a large record of load data, power system load data you are having over the past years, and you want to forecast the load for the next year or some 2025, what will be the load for the particular area. So you want to forecast the load, or you want to forecast some wind energy. What type of problem is this? Classification or regression problem? You just take time to think. Here problem two is, I am going to develop a software, and I am going to develop a software for determining whether my microgrid status. So all the microgrids will be going to have the tech support, and it is highly communicated with the technology, and the cyber security problem is always there in a microgrid. So here I want to determine whether a particular microgrid is hacked or not. So this is another type of problem available in power system security. So how you treat these problems? So for the first problem, we are going to forecast, which is a continuous values. The load may be in continuous range. So the first problem will be treated as regression problem. And the second problem, we are going to decide whether the particular micro power grid is hacked, or it is comfortable, or it is operating in normal condition. So we are going to generate only binary output here. So we have to treat this type of problems as a classification problem. So in unsupervised learning, what is the difference is, we have no idea about outputs, or we are having only minimum idea about the outputs. So here, what we are going to do is, we are going to perform the clustering of data. So many big data is available with this. What we are going to do with this data is, we are just going to categorize the data. So this amount of data from this particular microgrid is good. And this data is not a normal data. So based on the learning, the algorithm itself will classify some of the data, and then we can give the label for each classification. So this type of learning is unsupervised learning. So to understand the unsupervised learning, I have here listed 4 different problems, machine learning problems. In the 4 different problems, which problem will you treat as a unsupervised learning algorithm? So number first problem is, given a database of customer, discover market segments and group the customers. So the second one is, so if you are interestingly participating, you can also type your answers in your chat box, whether 1 is an unsupervised algorithm, 2 is unsupervised, or 3 or 4. So if you want to give your answers, you can type in your chat box. The second thing is for email. So whatever email we are receiving, some of the mails may be spam and some of the mails may be not spam. And we'll be going to have a machine learning algorithms in our email to detect whether the incoming email is a spam or not. So whether this problem can be treated as unsupervised. And the third problem, given a set of news articles found on the web, we need to group them into articles about the similar stories. And the fourth problem, for the data set of patients diagnosed. So this is a medical problem. So this is applicable for breast cancer, COVID, or severe other brain problems. So for the basic diagnostic things, we need to classify the new patients. So in these 4 problems, which problem you will treat as an unsupervised learning algorithm? Let me wait for 20 seconds. And if you are interested, you can type on your chat box. And I'm viewing the chat box. I expect at least 2 or 3 to type some answers. You just type the number. If you think number 1 problem is an unsupervised problem, you can just type 1. If you think second problem is unsupervised, 2. Or 1, 2, 3, for any number, you can just type. I just want you to know whether which is unsupervised. Unsupervised means we are not able to have idea about the output. So I'm getting few answers. Here, the answers are, one and three. And why this 1 and 3 is treated as unsupervised? Let me view 2 and 4. So for a 2, second problem, email labeled as spam or not spam. So this can be a supervised problem. And from the already coming emails, we know which is a spam mail and not spam mail. Giving all these details into the system, into the machine, and if it learns, it has both the data of input and output. So I'm just giving the input of different emails, and I am also giving a data about the previous mails, whether this type of mail is spam, this type of mail is not spam. So that information is also available, and I'm giving the whole information to the machine, and it is learning. So here output is available. So second problem is a supervised problem. It is not an unsupervised. Similarly, for the fourth thing, many patients are coming and taking a diagnosis, and we are having so many of data. For this particular symptoms, the output may be positive. For these symptoms, this output may be COVID negative. So we are having so much of data, and we are using these data for training our machine. So this problem is also a supervised learning problem. But in first and third problems, you know, it is just a data, big data. We are having so many data. The machine itself needs to automatically discover market segments. So if I browse continuously the Amazon website and I am searching some particular things, then it will group my preferences as a particular group. So next time if I log in, the machine learns that I like certain things. So it will start displaying certain things to me. So here I am not giving any output. The machine itself learns by the browsing status of the customer. So here these problems can be treated as unsupervised. So similarly, the third problem, there are many news articles, and based on the information in the article, it is going to separate. It is cinema news, it is politics news, it is COVID news. So such that it is going to separate the article. So without giving the information, it is going to do it. So these problems can be treated as unsupervised problem. So first we start up with the supervised problem. The supervised problem, I reiterate, it's classified into two types, regression and classification. So in the regression, I have taken a very simple example where the y-axis is the size of the house and x-axis is the price of the house. So now I am having the data of this house and I am having the data of this house. Similarly, I am having the data of so many houses and I am plotting a graph with the x-axis as the size of a house and y-axis as the cost of a house. Now I am interested in a new house. So I just want to understand, want to predict the cost of this house. So I am having some data points, but I am not having an exact data point for this house. So what will be the best estimate price of this house? So what I need to do is, I will be just trying to model all these points as a, so for a linear regression, I'm going to have a linear straight line, which may connect all these points. So if you draw a line connecting all these points, it is not possible to connect all the lines. We are going to give only the best fit. So I'm just drawing a line. So it is a straight line equation. So the model of this problem is a straight line. And the equation of the straight line is y is equal to mx plus c, where m is the slope and c is the intercept. So here, if I am able to find out a line equation, then for this value of x, I am able to find the value of y. So what is the best estimate for the price? Can you give the answer in the chat box? 80,000 or 120,000 or 190,000? Which will be the best optimum solution for this particular problem? You can type it in the chat box. And frequently I will ask these questions to type you in the chat box, to understand whether you are continuously following me. And Pratham has given a very exact solution, which is not given in the choose the best answer. Here I have given the choose the best answer. So everybody can easily understand the problem and all your answers are fine, very good. You are giving a very correct answer. And for any difficult problem, if you are having an expression, y is equal to mx plus c, then we can have, for substituting the value of x, you can determine the y. So the same thing we are doing here. So in the linear regression, the mathematical model will be in this style. We are having too much of training sets. And we are giving the training sets to the learning algorithm and the algorithm starts learning. And the inputs are size of house. And based on the information the system learns, it is going to give the estimated price. So this is the thing. The hypothesis I am testing is the equation of a straight line. So theta naught plus theta 1 x is nothing but an equation of straight line. So y is equal to mx plus c. Here, in our machine learning languages, as this thing, as here I have considered only one feature, the equation is mx plus c, direct straight line equation. If you are having too many features, x1, x2, x3, then it will be convenient to use theta value for the thing. So this is a hypothesis. So what is the thing I need to determine is, so machine learning is, machine has to determine the value for theta naught and theta 1. That is machine learning. So based on the inputs I am giving, the machine need to, so what is the thing is, I am in the, I am having many data points in my hand. So I am having some data and this data can be drawn as a graph. So everything is same. The data can be represented as a graph. The same data or the same graph can also be modeled as an equation. So all these three things are one and the same. So if you have data, you can draw a graph. If you have a data, you can develop a mathematical equation. If you have a mathematical equation, you can develop your own points. If you have a mathematical equation, you can draw the graph. So all three are one and same. Now in machine learning, we are having many points in our hand, and machine learning is nothing but it determines suitable equation for the data set available. So machine learning is very simple. We are going to develop a mathematical model for the available data points. So for developing the mathematical model means it has to find the values for theta naught and theta 1. So we are going to develop a cost function, which is the difference between, so if I substitute different theta values here, and if I check with the data set, I'll be getting some different y. For different values of theta, different y will be there. And as a supervised learning algorithm, I am having an actual y. So that if the actual y is equal to the estimated y, then the learning is very fine. The value of theta naught and theta 1 is correct. The equation is correct. So what is the cost function is? It is a difference between the calculated value and the actual output. So I want to minimize the error between this calculated value and actual y. For that, I need to change the value of theta 1 and theta naught. For a particular theta naught and theta 1, this function will be very much minimized. So how we can calculate the value of theta naught and theta 1? The basic algorithm is gradient descent algorithm. This algorithm is frequently used in a basic machine learning problem. And the very simple equation we used from the gradient descent algorithm is continuous updation of the variables that we need to determine by this equation. So gradient descent algorithm is based upon the differentiation. And as more optimization sessions have been gone, you, at this time, you clearly understand the maximum or minimum of any function is obtained when the differentiation becomes zero. So the differentiation plays a very important part in a gradient descent. So we are differentiating the cost function and multiplying with learning rate. And this learning rate should be chosen very carefully. So if the learning rate is very too small, then the convergence, so if this is the very minimum point for theta 1, I want to reach this point. If learning rate is very small, the gradient descent is very slow. If learning rate is very fast, then gradient descent will overshoot. So the selection of this learning rate is very important. And here, many optimization algorithms is also applied to determine the value of this learning parameter in machine learning. So once I decide this equation for straight line, so if it's a single order function, it's a linear regression. If I increase the order, the second order, third order, then we get some other equation. For any regression models, after performing the models, what are all the performance metrics we are using is, the first one is mean absolute error. So here, these are the data points, and this is the equation I have obtained. So definitely there is an error with respect to each and every point. So if I sum all the errors, then it is a mean absolute error. If this mean absolute error is equal to zero, it indicates all the points are lying only in the straight line. There is no error. So the fitting is very perfect. And it is not possible in any practical real-time problems. So what we are trying to do is, we need minimum value of this mean absolute error. So for different values, if the mean absolute, you can take this as a performance index, and if mean absolute error is less than some tolerance value, you can declare your model is working fine. And we are having mean squared error also. So to handle the positive and negative errors, we'll be having the mod value or squared value. So in the mean squared error, we'll be taking the square of the error between the actual estimation and the original point. So the actual estimation is some y is equal to mx plus c. Here I substitute the value of x. For this straight line, I will be getting only this point, but the target value is here. So this is the error. So we can easily understand what is the difference between target and the estimated. So similarly, you are having some more performance indexes like root mean squared error, which is having the mean value is taken as a root, and this RMSE is also a very good performance metrics for our machine learning problem. And we can take a mean absolute error. So sometimes the error is in positive direction and sometimes the error will be in negative direction. If you add mean absolute error, then they may cancel and the net error may not be visible. For that, we can take a absolute error. And we can also have mean absolute percentage error. So if each and every performance metrics have its own formula, so that we can just substitute and you can obtain the performance metrics. And if the performance metrics is very minimum, the model is considered as a good model. If you are using MATLAB toolbox, and if you are using an artificial neural network for training your data set, you will be getting some R line, and the R2 score is calculated. So it's a very good performance index, and it is calculated by as a difference between 1 and your linear regression model error divided by simple average model. So if your linear regression model is having zero error, straight away this R2 will be equal to 1. And if you are having this value as a very much larger value, then 1 minus, so if both the errors are equal, that is, it's the worst system, then 1 minus 1 will be equal to 0. R2 score range between 0 to 1 implies that 1 is the very best model, 0 is the very worst model. So these are the different performance metrics that are used in a linear regression. So other basic algorithms that we used for a classification problem is here. So the basic algorithms are Naive's Bayes method, decision tree, logistic regression, and neural network, support vector machine. And for understanding all these things, let me show let me play a video so that you can easily understand. I'm not able to view my video screen. Can you say whether you can able to view my video, or you are just seeing the simple screen?
We are seeing only that folder.
You can see only that folder. Then I need to quit and enter. I think now you can view a screen, video screen, detecting spam emails, right, ma'am?
Yes, we can see.
Okay, let us take a very simple example. I am having a bunch of emails in my inbox and I want to differentiate. I want to find the spam. So what I can do, I don't want unnecessary mails. So what I can do is, I am finding some keywords. Let my keyword is cheap. If I found any words cheap on my mail, probably it may be a spam. So I am just checking my algorithm and I am testing my 25 mails. So out of 25 mails, I'm just seeing that 20 mails that has a word cheap is a definitely a spam. But I am also having some good mails consist of that characters. So if I use this only word for my classification, what is the efficiency of this algorithm is 80%. That is, out of 25 mails, only 20 mails are spam, but my 5 good mails are also be considered as a spam. So here, for this particular word, the probability of the mails being a spam is 80%. So what I'll be going to do is, I'm just starting including my checking. So if there is some unavoidable spelling, more spelling mistakes in the mail, it may be a spam. And if I'm having some few missing title, it may be a spam. So I may increase my thing, and this particular algorithm is called as Naive Bayes algorithm. So here in this algorithm, we will be adding one by one features at a time, and we will be considering the classification, whether it is a spam or not. So this is a Naive Bayes algorithm. The second problem I am showing here, we are using many apps for our discussion. So somebody is using WhatsApp, Hangout, and Pico, man, app, different apps are using. So I am having some data set about the gender and age who and the apps used by them. So here what I am going to do is I'm going to classify. So I'm just looking on the data. I'm taking a set decision. So who's treating? So first classification, how I can make. So I'm just seeing the data and I am just viewing that age, if it is younger age are using Pico. So the younger age people are using Pokemon. So the first classification I am going to give based on age. So I am giving a branch. If the age is less than 20, they are using Pokemon app. If the age is greater than 20, what is there? So there are some more apps. So I am taking some decision based on the data. So here females are seem to be mostly using WhatsApp and males are seems to be using Hangout. So I am taking a decision that based on the gender, then I am giving the thing. So here, what is this? This is a decision tree. So we are going to if conditions, we are developing if conditions based on the data. And if we develop the things, then it is a decision tree. So then we consider the next problem. So you are giving two tests. And based on the result of two tests, I'm going to say whether the student is passed or failed. So my first test and second is grade. Based on these two things, I'm going to say. So the first student, if the test mark is 9 out of 10 and grade is 8 out of 10, definitely the student is passed. If the grade is 4 and test is 3, I'm going to fail the student. So here, if test is good and grades are somewhat minimum, how I can going to classify? So this type of classification problem will be having, so we are getting a data from the previous year students. What are their marks? How I am going to give whether they are declared pass or they have to take the test again. So to give that situation for this problem, for this particular problem and the data set, what will be your answer? Whether the student got accepted or not. So test is 7 and grades are 6. So the points will be around here. So the student is passed. So based on this type of things, we need to classify this. Here for this classification, we need to have a straight line which classifies the failure marks and positive marks. And this is called as logistic regression. In the logistic regression, we are going to split the data by a straight line. So here it comes the gradient descent. So here I have drawn a line, but it is not actually classifying correctly. If you see, I want to classify green points and red points. Here it is not classifying correctly. So what I am going to do is, here there are two errors. So I'm going to apply gradient descent and I am going to change the direction of the line. So at this point, the error is zero. I am just having the gradient. It is a very simple gradient descent. I am giving a gradient for that line. So this is the logistic regression. We are going to develop a straight line based on gradient descent. And here again, a similar problem occurs. What is the thing is, if I am having only one straight line that cut it out, and if a student get the marks like this in test, score is 9, but grade is very, very poor, 1 out of 10. Can I give acceptance? Can I give pass? No. So I have to develop something more than a logistic regression. One single line is not sufficient here. For that, what I can do is, I can go for neural network, which can give a more accurate classification than logistic regression. So to compare this logistic regression and a neural network. Neural network is a very simple logic in which we are treating our, modeling our brain network, how our brain works. So logistic regression is cutting a single line and neural networks is somewhat similar to the thing shown in the graph, which you can have a different cutting strength. So what is the next thing? So cutting line is, okay, we can understand based on gradient discussion, we are separating things. So we can have different styles. Here I have shown two lines. Which line will be a better line? Black or yellow? According to your visualize, you can enter the chat box whether you can view which one is better line, yellow or black. So everybody has given a thing, black line is right. And all your answers are exactly correct. So how we are saying that black line is better? So if you see the distance between the actual points and the lines here, I am just taking the distance between the line and the actual points. The distance between the line and actual points is greater than the in the black line. So yellow line, the difference is very good. Here comes the optimization. So now we are not at all having a gradient descent. Now I want to develop an optimization problem where the distance is maximum. So if you apply optimization here, then this will become a support vector machine. So the same problem I have shown whether how the same problem can be dealt with logistic regression, neural network, and if it is applied with the optimization, it becomes a support vector machine. And in the terminology of machine learning, there is a word called kernel, which is always confusing term. So to understand a kernel easily, I'm just showing a simple graphical representation. Here I am having some data points which cannot be separated by a single line. So what I can do for this thing? I should definitely have some curved line or something other than a straight line to split these two data points. So how it is this possible? So in this example, I just give a explanation of a kernel. What I am doing is, here it is a 2D space X and Y. So I am going to convert this 2D space into a 3D space with the additional axis Z, and here XY is plotted as such. And what I am doing is, I am going to separate the data. I am going to lift a particular data to up, and I am going to create a plane between the red and this green points. So both the things are same. If you are splitting the data by this curve, it is equal to having one more dimension and having a plane inside. So this plane is separating the green and white point, red point. So this is a kernel. So to understand how it is possible, I just show a simple example. So here I have given some data values, and here for a plane, the equation should involve both the X and Y. So here I have given three equations. For this particular problem classification, which equation will work fine? So for that, I am going to calculate the values for all these three equations. I am getting a values like this. Now you just type in the chat box the first, second or third equation. Which equation will be a very good plane to separate this data? Based on the answers we obtain, you can decide which equation will be a very good plane. 1, 2 or 3. You just go through this slide and you can answer. So here, so more explanation is required at this point. So I am just giving another, explaining again. So I am having this point. I need to differentiate, we need to classify green and red points. Here, straight line is not sufficient. So I need a plane. So plane will involve the expression of X and Y. So here I have given three expressions. So if I take the first expression X plus Y, for all the four data points, if I do this one, so X value is 0, Y value is 3. substituting this equation, the answer is 3. Here, take this point and substitute in the equation, answer is 3. So similarly, all the data points are substituted in the expression and the answers are given in this table. So which equation will act as an exact plane to classify? If you see, the equation XY will be having a huge difference between the red points and green points. Because if you multiply those points, for the red points, the answer is 0. For the green points, the answer is 2. So these two cases, we cannot differentiate because the first case in all the points, the answers are equal. So we cannot have a plane. In the things, the third thing, it is continuously rising. So we cannot have a plane. So the second one will be the answer. And if you see, XY is equal to 1. So here, if I have a plane like this, so here I have a plane. So this plane equation is XY is equal to 1. So that the green points will move to the above the plane and red points move below the plane. And this is actually the kernel trick. And I pause here. And if you have any particular doubt at this point of moment, you can type your doubts in the chat box. Because we are just going to move on to the another topic. So if you feel tough understanding this thing, then I can reiterate something. So all these basic algorithms, if you see in the power system applications, mostly in the power system analysis, security, operation and control, all the problems can be addressed by these type of algorithms. So these are classification problems and this NAIRS-based algorithm, which we have discussed with the email spam. There you can fault detection problem in the power system can be dealt with NAIRS-based algorithm. And for the security assessment, what are the different abnormality can occur? What are the preventive, if this particular abnormality occur, what are the preventive action I need to take? So such that we can have a analysis using decision tree in power system problems. And for power quality analysis, there are too many problems available. And this logistic regression can be used for those classification. Whether it is a SAG problem, swell problem, or any other power quality analysis, we can use this logistic regression for classifying the data. And neural network is a very, very powerful tool. And almost in each and every field of power system, this neural network is applied. Let me see the chat box if anyone having doubts. And as there are no particular doubt, I am just going to continue. And once we design the model, we have to check which model is better. So if you see these two models for classification, better we, on viewing this, we see this as a very good model. This may not seem to be a good model because if there are some problem in the classification, here the problem is accurately modeled. So, but this is the first order equation. So it's a straight line equation, it's a first order equation. Here if you see, it is a one order 1, order 2, order 3, order 4, order 5. Nearly the order is here 5. So the problem is complex problem. So what we can understand is, if you model the problem as a complex problem, the machine can learn well. But there is a dangerous learning here, which is called as overfitting. Because to understand the overfitting, what we are going to do is, if you are having an old set of data points, you should take some of the data points out as a testing point. So we should not involve those points for training the data. So here I am taking some filled points as a training data and unfilled points as a testing data. So for training data, this algorithm, this complex algorithm will fantastically classify the training data. But coming to the test data, this particular complex algorithm will fail. And this problem is called an overfitting problem. So if you compare this one, training for any data sets, if you are having 1,000 number of data, you should separate that data as a training data and testing data. You should not use the testing data for training purpose. So if you are using some 800 data for training, after training you have to use the remaining 200 data for testing, so that you can obtain the performance of the machine learning algorithm. So if you model a very complex thing, it will overfit the training data and it will not work good on test data. So the testing is very important. So if algorithm seems to be very much good fit in a training data, we cannot sure say it will perform good on testing data also. So to understand this, what we will be doing is, we will be doing cross validation while training the data. So what is this cross validation? If you are having so many data, so suppose here each dot represents some hundreds of data, means here I am having 1200 data, for example. So what I am going to do is, for each time, so what I'll be doing is, I'll be taking some 300 data out and I won't use this data for training. So the remaining data will be used for training, and after once the system is trained, machine is trained, I'm going to use this data for testing and I will be noting the performance of the machine learning algorithm. Then what I will be doing is, I'll be changing the next 300 data as a test data and I'll be using the remaining data for the training process. And I'll be calculating the performance index again. Similarly, this k-fold cross validation will be repeatedly running the machine learning algorithms again and again with different training data and different testing data. So here we'll be having only 1200 data set. I am taking some 300 data out. I am using 900 data for training. I am developing a model. You should not stop with this. You have to do again this particular training process with different 900 data as a training and different 300 data as a set. So in each thing, if the performance, if you calculate the performance and you can have a validate. If in all the four cases, the performance is good, your machine learning process is good. If it is not so, it refers to the overfitting problem, which in which algorithms work fine on training data, but it won't work fine on testing data. So we need to address the problem. And you can also give randomizing in the cross-validation process also. You can take the testing data in random process. And the evaluation metrics. So how you are going to evaluate whether after detecting my model, whether it is a good model or node model, we need to develop a confusion matrix. So what is a confusion matrix? Suppose I'm having diagnosing a COVID patient and this is the original status of the patient. So this is the original patient status of the patient. And here I am giving the some features of the patient to my machine learning algorithm and my algorithm is diagnosing whether they are actually sick or not. So if the person is actually sick and the algorithm also diagnosed sick, then it is called as true positive. So this true refers to the correctness of a diagnosis. Positive refers to what is the thing. So I am referring, I am fixing a COVID positive means, so it is a positive case. So true negative mention, the diagnosis is true and the COVID is negative. So the patient is healthy. He is not having any COVID. So true positive is sick and also diagnosed sick, and true negative is healthy person diagnosed correctly as healthy. So then what is false negative? If a sick person is diagnosed as a healthy person, then the detection is false. And falsely you are saying the COVID is negative in him. Actually he is a COVID positive patient, but we are detecting as falsely detecting it is negative. So it is false negative. Similarly, false positive is the algorithm's detective falsely as a COVID. So he is not a COVID patient, but we are detecting him as a COVID positive. So it is false positive. So for this data points, how you are developing a confusion matrix? So here my problem statement is detecting, classifying the blue points. So guessed positive. So blue point is a positive point and red point is a negative point. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 6 blue points are detected correctly. So true positives are 6 and true negatives are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 5 red points are correctly given as in the negative side and falsely given points are given. So it is a confusion matrix. And based on the confusion matrix, we are having basic indexes like accuracy. The accuracy is, if it is a diagnosis problem, out of all the data, how much data we classify correctly. So here I am having 10,000 data, and in the 10,000 data, I have classified that is true positive and true negative or 1,000 and 8,000. So these are correctly classified points. And the total points is 10,000, total data is. So the accuracy is correctly determined by the total detection. That is 90% in this case. But whether the accuracy gives the correct evaluation matrix means, for the medical model, false positives are okay, but false negatives are highly risk. You should not give an estimate like this, because false negatives may result in loss of life. In a spam detector problem, false positives cannot be okay, but false negatives. So spam may be come to inbox, but my important mail should not go to spam. So here false positive is not okay. So it depends upon the problem. So we need some more evaluation metrics. So for the same value, if I calculate the accuracy for the classification problem, it is equivalent to correctly classified points to all points, and it is 78%. For the same thing, we are giving another matrix called precision. Here, the precision said out of the points we have predicted to be positive. So we have predicted so many points as positive, and for that, how many is correct. So the precision is given as a ratio of true positives to the sum of true positives and false positives. So accuracy is here, precision is different from accuracy. And this precision can be taken as an index for medical problem. So here we are having another matrix called recall. Here, out of the points labeled positive, how many we predict correctly? So if this is the case study, then the equation for recall will be ratio of true positives to the sum of true positives and false negatives. Here, this type of performance index is required for spam mails. So precision can be used for measuring the performance for medical problem, and this recall can be used for spam detector. So accuracy cannot be always used as exact as a performance index. So that's the point I want to mention here. So according to the problem that we are taking, we need to choose the best performance index that we need. So for a medical problem, we can, if you calculate the precision, precision is very minimum and recall is maximum. So which one we can take it? So this precision recall plays an important role, and these are two indexes. Again, it will confuse the performance of the machine learning. So based on these things, one score is obtained, which is called as F1 score. So F1 score is nothing but the average of precision and recall. Very simple calculation, which converts the two performance indices to single performance indices, F1 score. And we should not take a average mean of anything as a performance study. So because if you are having many data, here I am having 5 data, and 4 data is in single digit and 1 data is in 2 digit, and it is higher number. If you take a arithmetic mean, there will be a misleading in the solution. So you should take a harmonic mean, which follows the harmonic formula. Here, the representative error will be minimum. Normally, this F1 score should not be taken as an arithmetic mean of precision and recall. It should be taken as a harmonic mean of precision and recall. And the different types of errors that we encounter is underfitting and overfitting. So whenever we are making a machine learning problem, the major errors are underfitting and overfitting. What is underfitting? If you are using a net to defeat a dragon or a monster, then it is underfitting. Or if you are using an atom bomb to kill a fly, it is overfitting. Both are unnecessary. You should choose the best fitting model for the best thing. So the major problems is a bias and variance. So bias is the inability of an algorithm to capture the true relationship. So the relationship is actually here. It is a curve, but we are doing a linear regression because the model is very simple in linear regression. So this is biasing. And what is variance? So the variance is the difference in the data set. So So if I am giving some data set, I am having some model like this, and if I am using k-fold algorithm, and again if I model, I am getting some other equation like this, and I am again in the next k-fold, I am getting the different model like this. So the variation in the model itself should be less. So this is another problem which leads to overfitting. So the underfitting is a major problem occur due to bias, and overfitting is a major problem occurs due to variance. So if I am designing a system, if I am having only my modeling degree is 1 means it is a straight line, modeling degree is 2 means it will be a curve, and modeling degree if I increases accordingly the curve will be going on increasing. So the first case the bias is very much higher, so I am not concentrating on the true relationship of the value. So I'm just biasing over. So here degree is 1. And if I give very much greater degree, the problem goes complex. The detecting the values, modeling with this, all these complex, is not so much easy. It has many mathematical toughness in calculating all the coefficients of this model. So we are going to work on a complex model, but after working, even though the training set works well, the test set may not work well. So you have to go for different orders, and you have to pick a just right model here. And you can pick the just right model by having the different k-fold algorithms and what will be the training error and testing errors in different modelings. And accordingly, you can develop your final machine learning model. So for the same problem, for the same data set, I can have any model. But after training all those things, I have to give only one model as a solution. So it is, the model should not have any high bias or high variance. This model is having high bias and this model is having high variance. So these two are the major problems. So you have to take different models and you have to calculate the F1 score. And based on the F1 score, you have to choose the final model for your problem. And I can stop here, and the time is 11 now, and let me take one or two questions if you have. Or I just go through the chat if you are having any doubts on the chat. So no questions on chat. If you have any...
Just a minute, ma'am. Let us wait, ma'am.
Okay, ma'am.
Yeah. Any textbook for fundamentals of machine learning?
Now, actually, machine learning has been introduced as an elective course in UG itself, and there are many more books on machine learning. Actually, what are the slides I have shown, and the video is taken from YouTube, Udacity University. And they are having a collectively a very good videos for learning the machine learning algorithms. And I have undergone a machine learning course in a Coursera. It's a very wonderful course given by Andrew, who is a founder of a machine learning. And I have taken all this information from these two things, that YouTube video and the Coursera.
One participant is online, ma'am.
Yes, madam.
Pratap, sir.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you. Yeah. Ma'am, I have a very particular question. This might be a long question, but I will try to make it concise as much as possible. So, for non-power system machine learning problems, like for example, this automatic driving, they have test sets already available. Like this is a stop sign, this is a pedestrian crossing, zebra crossing, this is a car, tree, everything. And for neuro-linguistic programming, NLP, for detecting handwritings, text, they have a test set, like what is A, what is B, all like millions and millions. There are companies which develop these test set. But when coming to our electrical, for example, I'm working on a power quality machine learning thing, where I'm trying to identify if this is a sag or swell or, it's a harmonic situation, whatever it is. Where do we have, for electrical, Where do we have such training set and testing set? Someone has to create that, no? And I cannot, as an engineer, I cannot create millions and millions of test sets because that will consume most of my time. So how do we tackle this problem?
Actually, those who are doing power system research in machine learning, what they are actually doing is they are taking a particular system and they are developing a data set. And as you mentioned, millions and millions of data set creation is not possible for a researcher to develop in power system. But what we can do is, according to the problem specification, so we are having some standard systems, IEEE systems, and in what the problem we are working for. Actually, in the last semester, we have did a fault analysis problem, and as a problem, as you have mentioned, this power quality problem, what we are doing is, we are developing a neural network scheme for the classification. And for that, what we are doing is, we are developing a Simulink or MATLAB coding in which we are varying the elements in the coding or a simulation itself, and we are creating a data set. So when you write appropriate coding, developing a or creating a data set will not be a difficult task. And about what we have done in the power quality problems is, we have created our own SACs, wells in the test system, and we take the output. And similarly, we have created up to some 500 data sets. And while training the system, what we did is, we duplicate this data sets in the training. So suppose if I am having some 600 data points in my hand, what I'll be doing is, I am shuffling those data points again, and I think that I am having 1200 data sets with me. And in that, I'll be taking out some test data should be first removed, and then the remaining data is duplicated for better training. So this is one option you can do. And I think there are some websites in which some of the data are available, smart grid data are available. I'm not very confident about the website address, but if you search, the students are now taking some real-time data from a particular website. And if I know, I'll be shared with the organizers.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you very much.
One more question.
Yes, ma'am.
How to use machine learning in power system stability?
Power system stability is like an ocean. So there are many problems in power system stability, starting from a swing equation or a finding out the stability of a machine to... So there are many problems involved, madam. So what is the problem we are using? So whether we are going to treat a problem as a monitoring problem or a controlling problem. So first we need to formulate the problem, whether it's classification or regression, or whether it is a want to monitor something or we want to control something. So you have to first fix the problem clearly. And for that problem, we need to develop the data set. Then you can suitable machine learning algorithm to address the problem. You can apply in any field.
And last question from one of the participants. Can we use machine learning concept to detect and prevent losses in the power system?
Detecting losses, you can certainly use. But preventing losses means you can have a recommendation system like this, because the machine learning itself won't reduce the loss. But the machine learning will learn the structure of a system, and it may calculate the loss for you. If there are some changes, what will be the effect on the losses? It may be developed using machine learning. But coming to the controlling of loss, we have to physically set up some things. But we can have a recommender system for this particular loss. The machine can give a recommending system. Just in this particular line, you can install such a thing. You can use some decision tree or recommending app algorithm to be given. But using machine learning, we cannot directly reduce the losses. You can give recommendation, and you can also have some control type of problems. If you have a particular device that can be operated to reduce the loss, you can take a decision of the operation of a device using the machine learning. We can monitor, we can control. A neural network is the best tool. You can begin with neural network for all those problems.
We are having many questions in the chat box, ma'am, but due to time restriction, I am just limiting this question as last question. So can you briefly describe the steps to locate the fault in an electrical network using machine learning?
Yes, ma'am. Actually, what similar study we have performed, what we have done is we have taken a n number of n bus system. For example, 9 bus system means we are creating that n bus system in a simulation or some other thing. In our problem, what we did is we create a simulation box and we randomly create a particular error in a particular line. So we know if the error occurs, what is the changes in the line parameters. So we input that one and we take the fault data. So if the inputs are like this, the fault is on the fifth line. The inputs are like the fault is on the sixth line. So we are creating a data sets like this, and we are using some training algorithms to learn. And after learning, if I give some new feature, then my machine is able to give the answer for this particular features. The problem is at fifth line, and it the distance from the line is some 100 meters. After the 100 meters, there is a fault. So even we are using the line which has a fault and the distance of the fault from the line. Everything you give as a generate as a data, and if you use it as a training set, then you can create a wonderful model which gives an exact location of the fault for any new fault.
Pratap sir, any more questions?
Yes, ma'am. One last one. Thank you for the time. Man, this is a general question. As an industrial person, this is directed towards Dr. Kavita and also Kavita ma'am, also the professors and other people from South Engineering College and other academic people. For as an industrial person, how can I collaborate with universities and colleges like yours? Like I'm based from US, and here colleges and companies collaborate a lot, and they get a lot from universities. And I'm sure it's happening in India as well, but I personally don't know. How can we as industrial person collaborate with you people to bring these research things as a commercial product?
Actually, this type of collaboration is highly welcome in most of the institutions, sir. Actually speaking, that should be a mutual concern. So if you are you want to work with the university people, your company should allow you. So everything should be official. So if you have a certain problem, and if the researchers can do something for you, definitely there is a lot of collaboration schemes from the government side also. They are asking for huge projects which can have these type of industry collaborations also. So everything may be official, and it is actually going on in most of the institutions.
Pratap sir, actually we are ready to collaborate with industry. So we are also trying to have industry institute collaboration only. So definitely we can have, as Kavita ma'am told, definitely we can have a mutual understanding, and we can act as a consultant also, sir.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you very much.
Yeah.
Shall I put a point here, ma'am?
Yeah, tell me, Joel.
Actually, how the industry starts with here right now, in this perspective, I can say industries can propose or give the problem statements that actually prevails in the industry. And the academicians can discuss on that. And the problems which can be taken over by the academicians can be discussed, and then it can be done. That's it.
Yeah.
First, the industry has to propose or tell the problem statements to the academicians. We can share it if it can be taken, if it is a simulation project, or if it is something like which can be done in systems, we can do it, sir. Or if it should be done in physically, like in the machines, then we have to put a memorandum of understanding, and we have to make collaborations with the government too. If it is with the simulation, then we can help you directly, sir.
Okay, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you. All right. So, thank you, Kavita ma'am. Thank you, madam.
For all the participants to patiently listen to me and answering me. Here I have a wonderful experience with you all, and thank you all for your support.
Thank you, Kavita ma'am, for giving us a very basic explanation about this machine learning algorithm and where